Good morning. I think we can start so that we don't run late. So welcome. So as this conference unfolds, we are witnessing the remarkable breadth of Bourgain's work. In each of many fields, he has resolved long-standing problems, always with novel tools and often, as somebody noted yesterday, from scratch. Another thing that someone noted, not here but somewhere else where I once overheard, is that he's the best user of his many techniques. So he invents all these techniques and he single-handedly is more than anyone else knows how to use them in many different ways. So many of his results are either final or remain the best known, and they're usually inequalities for a long period of time. Okay, so this morning the topic that we've tried to put together is that of theoretical computer science, especially complexity theory, and the closely allied subject of combinatorics. Both are ideally suited to Jean's tastes. His results here range from his sharp distortion theorems for embedding of finite metric spaces into Euclidean space, to his constructions of pseudo-random objects, expanders, extractors, which are central in de-randomization algorithms and purification of weak sources of randomness. Many of the last, actually, these last results of his use the works on his bounding of exponential sums coming from arithmetic combinatorics that we heard a bit about on the first day. In a quite different direction, but still very much in line of Jean's interests, is finite Fourier analysis of Boolean functions, especially functions which take only the values 0 and 1. So this is the theory of the Walsh group, but where the values are choosing just 0 and 1 makes for the functions to have very subtle spectral properties. And one of the topics there is the study of how these functions, which are hard to compute, vary under noise. We might hear a bit of that from our speaker. So that brings me to our speaker today, who's Gil Kalai from the Hebrew University. He is a world leader in the interface between combinatorics, convex geometry, and complexity theory. And besides his many fundamental theorems, and there are many of them, he's also a well-developed, has a very well-developed comic side. In fact, each time he performs, he ups the ante for his next performance. So this puts some pressure on him, which I am right now. But anyway, for those of you who've been lucky enough to witness many of his talks, it's a pleasure to see this weekly monotone function, meaning there are occasional little blips. But today I'm sure will be fantastic. The title of his talk is Combinatorics of Boolean Functions and Some Applications.
Okay, so, thank you very much, Peter. Is it working?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you very much, Peter. And it's really a great honor and to be here in this conference celebrating Jean Bourgain's mathematical work. And I widen a little bit the scope of my lecture, trying to share you with my personal celebration of Jean's work and my interaction with Jean. And the story of Boolean function will be fairly major. And I want to start with a problem for which some very recent development was made. This is a problem that I certainly mentioned to Jean several times, and perhaps we talked about it a few times. And this is the cup set problem. And a cup set in 0, 1, 2 to the n is a set containing no three distinct element, x, y, and z, that sum up to 0. Or equivalently, a set that does not contain three-term arithmetic progression, or f n line, it's all the same thing. And we are interested in f of n, which is the maximum size of such a set. So we look at the group 0, 1, 2, z3 to the n, and inside it, we want to find a set without three-term arithmetic progression. And this is a very interesting question, and we can ask a similar question for 4 to the n, and let's write gn to be the maximum size of a set without a sweet arithmetic progression in 0, 1, 2, 3 to the n. And I think perhaps there is an even earlier history, but in 87, Frankel, Graham, and Redl, I think, raised the question and proved that f of n is little o of 3 to the n. And then in an important paper, Roy Meshulam proved that f of n is big O of 3 to the n divided by n in 95. And many people tried to improve this bound, including Roy and I. We worked on it quite extensively in the early 2000s without success. In 2009, Tom Sanders managed to improve the bound for Z4, and he showed that there the bound is little over 4 to the n over n. And then there was a breakthrough result by Batman and Katz that managed to prove that f of n is a big O of 3 to the n divided by n to the 1 plus a. And I should say the Roy Meshulam method is an application of Ross method, which is for the classical Ross theorem about sets of integers without 3 terms arithmetic progression, except that it's even easier and clearer. And Batman and Katz use Fourier method, but much more difficult. Okay, so a few weeks ago, there were some very remarkable development about this problem. On my fave, in May 5, there was a paper on the archive by Ernie Kroot, Sevalev, and Peter Pach, which proved that g of n is big O of 3.61 to the n. So this was an exponential improvement over the previous bound. And a few days later, Jordan Ellenberg and Dion Hesweit managed to achieve this for the original K problem using the method of Kroot, Lev, and Pach, and proved that f of n is exponentially small compared to 3 to the n. It's no bigger than 2.756 to the n. So one can say that the CAPSET problem has been solved. Of course, it would be interesting to know the precise constant, but this is something we couldn't even dream 4 weeks ago. Yeah? Yes? Yeah, this is what I said. It would be interesting, you know, until a few weeks ago, we didn't know that anything better than 3 to the n divided by n to the 1.0001. So
I think he's asking about the lower bound.
Oh, about the lower bound. Okay, I'll get to that. But the lower bound, so one obvious lower bound for f of n is to take all the 0, 1 vectors. This, they don't contain a sweet term arithmetic progression. And this is 2 to the n, and there was a construction by Adele, which is 2.2 to the n, and slightly better. So the proof used a method, a very important method in combinatorics and also other areas. It's called the polynomial method. I think Larry Guth mentioned it regarding the finite field Kakea problem. Very roughly, it says that given a set A with a certain property, you associate to every element a polynomial in a certain space of polynomial. You use the combinatorial property to show that these polynomials are linearly independent, and this leads you to the bound that the size of A is less or equal to the dimension of S. You may ask, why is this problem interesting, important, and the CAPSET problem? I personally really like it a lot. It is related to various other questions in combinatorics, to the sunflower conjecture, and it is can be regarded as a model problem for the question about sets without arithmetic progression over the integers. So let me remind you this analogy. So over the integers, there is a longer history. Ross proved that a set without a sweet term arithmetic progression among the first n element can be of size at most n divided by log log n. Other proofs, which only gave little of n, were very important in furthering pushing such questions. They were found later. Then Semeredi and his Brown improved it to n divided by log to the an, where a is small, perhaps 1 over 6. There was a very important paper by Jean Bourgain who proved the bound n divided by log by square root log n. And this This required a whole new technology to deal with what's called Borset. Again, it's the Fourier method. And Bourgain further improved the bound to n divided by log to the 2/3 n. And then Tom Sanders almost reached the log n barrier and proved n divided by log n, but up to log log n to the 6, which was even further improved. The exponent 6 was improved further by Bloom. And when the Bethmann and Katz breakthrough came, people certainly hope, and they still hope, that the method they introduced will translate to the integer case. There are several difficulties and complications, but they certainly thought about it. And now, as of the last 3 weeks, we have a huge improvement on the right-hand side for the cup set problem, exponential improvement. And this suggests that maybe an analog improvement will be found also for the integers. For the integers, the lower bound, the best construction due to Behrend is maybe 8 years old, is exponential in the square root of log n. I'm sorry, n over that is the lower bound. Yeah, my mistake. N over that, sorry. Yes, the challenge, and I think this is a challenge, a very nice challenge, is to apply or adapt the polynomial method to obtain a Behrend quality lower bound for R3n, and to consider larger arithmetic progressions to try to get any bounds for Ross theorem using this method. There are some cases in combinatorics where there were alternative methods to the polynomial method by some direct combinatorial techniques. We can look at them back also in the context of this problem. So this is a very exciting, something that happened right now. So my talk will go backward chronologically. So this is news from the last days. And I want to mention my meeting with Jean in Berkeley 2013. I was there for a semester in Berkeley, and I learned that Jean is half secretly spend a few days every 2 weeks in Berkeley. And we met a few times. Once we met in this place. This is the Strada Cafe, just one of the sides of the campus. And here's the problem I asked Jan there. I think it's a nice problem, and I want to share it with you. It's not related to the rest of the talk, but I think it's a very nice problem. You have a small alphabet, omega, and a large alphabet, sigma. So you want to encode all words of length n with letters in omega by words of length n with letters from sigma. And ordinary codes, you allow to do it in an arbitrary way. And there is a remarkable class of codes which are called Schulman tree codes. They were introduced by Leonard Schulman in 93. And he wanted to do it in a prefix preserving way. So if you do it for words of smaller size, and if two words have the same prefix, this bind your encoding. And the task in both cases is to be able to correct a constant fraction of errors, although for the tree codes, you have to be more explicit about what you want, more precise about what you want. And after many years, for ordinary codes, there are explicit constructions, but so far, there are no explicit constructions for tree codes. And Schulman and Moore found example based on a certain exponential sum conjecture. And I mentioned it to Jean. So my policy, especially when it's not my problem, so it was mentioned that Jan has this amazing ability to juggle between a lot of problems. But I still think I don't want to burden him. So usually my policy is I mention to him a problem, and only if he expresses interest enough that he come back to me, ask me, please send me the, then I send him the. But in this case, he asked me and I sent him. So this is still open. I don't know if this particular exponential sum direction will be useful. And over the year, I realized that Jan is really interesting to hear a lot of problems from many directions, and it's too sharp, his skills. So let me go back a little bit to Lund 2012. So here, Jan and Terry Tao received the Crawford Award and we had a little conference, and there was this drawing on the left which showed how harmonic analysis through the work of Jean and Terry is moving and conquering neighboring areas. So this is sort of a metaphor which can be appealing, especially to people of my gender. So this were nice. Let me move on to the next topic. This is a Möbius randomness. So this is a question that initiated from a colloquium lecture by Peter Sarnak, 2011 at the Hebrew University. And then the question, so Peter makes some provocative remarks about complexity, and this raised all sorts of questions by myself and by Dorit Aronov, Michael Benor, and other people. And it led to a specific question. So I should say, I should tell you what is Möbius randomness or what is a prime number theorem. It's not, I'm cheating a little bit, but we'll say that a function of integer or positive integer with values 1 and minus 1 has the satisfy the prime number theorem or the Möbius randomness if its correlation with the Möbius function, if you sum up the first n element of the Möbius function times your function, then this is little of n. So the constant 1 function is the correlation of the constant 1 function with the Möbius function go to 0, and this is essentially the prime number theorem. And oh, this is mu. I have some. Okay, so it should be mu, the Möbius function. I apologize. This is not part of the comic part, but just my mistake. So, following Peter and some correspondence we had, I wrote some blog post and the mass overflow question, where I raised the question if the prime number theorem apply for digital arithmetic functions defined by bounded depth circuits. So it's functions of the integers which can be described by bounded depth circuits. And this was answered positively by Ben Green. And there was an even more general question whether the prime number theorem holds for digital arithmetic functions defined by linear forms over Z over 2Z. And this was settled positively by Jean Bourgain. And later, Jean proved the variety of related results. For example, he proved that for digital arithmetical function defined by monotone expression, monotone, so if the 0 and 1 are monotone in the bits, then again you have prime number theorem. In some of this case, you know, the little of n, I'm sorry about the mu, but the little of n is you would like to have even better estimate, like n divided by log n, in some case even a power, n to the power 1 minus epsilon, And Jean achieved that in certain of these questions. There is still a problem which is largely open, which is the Möbius randomness or prime number theorem for digital arithmetic functions defined by low degree Z over 2Z forms, like degree 2. And you can ask, why are digital arithmetic functions interesting? And I would admit that in some sense, it's more interesting to look at functions that we are familiar with, like polynomial or this generalized polynomial that Tammy talked about in her lecture, but we have to remember that every function, when we compute it, we do it digitally. So in some sense, the digital point of view is fairly general, and it would be nice to understand. And as for the question, what's next? So I really enjoyed asking questions and getting this answer, but at some point I thought I should sit down with Peter or with yes. No, this is just a name I give. So this is an arithmetic function which defined as based on the digits of the binary expansion of the number. Like you look at the digits and the function is 1 if there are more 1s than 0. So I just invented this name for this talk. Just, yeah. So I think so probably I should sit down with Peter and with Jean and try to see how this fits into the larger picture and then maybe I'll come up with. So, you know, you remember this wonderful lecture by Chaim Brzis yesterday where he said he managed to bring together Cauchy and Fourier, who worked at the same institution. And So this here, this time I brought together Peter and Jean, who also work in the same institution. Of course, unlike the case, or possibly the historical conjecture that Chaim made, Jean and Peter, even if you visit here not so regularly, you cannot avoid seeing the wonderful friendship and partnership between Jean and Peter over the years. So let me move on. Projections of sets of discrete cubes. So here is another coffee. This was much easier to find on Google, because in Princeton there is essentially only one coffee place. And what happened was, so one of, I don't remember which year it was, maybe 2014, 2013, I came to the Institute to give a talk. I stayed with my dear friend Edna and Avi Vigdorzon, and on Monday I gave the talk. I met Jean's wonderful administrative assistant, Ellie Gustafsson, and, you know, I asked her how are things, and she said that Jean is in California, but he sends regards, and he will come Monday night. And I said, now that he got this latest prize, maybe it was shock prize, or does Jean take it easy now? And he said, no, on the contrary, he works on the double. So we had this conversation several times regarding to several prizes. And then the next day, before I go to my travels, I meet a small world cafe, I see Jean, so I'm very happy to talk to him. So this is a second occasion this time. And then I told him about a result I had with Jeff Kahn. So with Jeff, we managed to push, we had some questions, which I think is fairly natural, it's even somewhat reminiscent of the cup set problem, about projections of the discrete cube on say, two-thirds of the coordinates, more than half the coordinates. And maybe you shouldn't read this, but we had some knowledge coming from the works in the 90s that, you know, since I go chronologically backward, I will mention this word a little bit. But, and we managed to push one direction, rather surprisingly. There was some, we managed to push one direction a little bit. I told it to Jean, and this time I didn't apply this algorithm because this is my problem. I thought, you know, send him the paper. And then a few days later, a few weeks later, he told me that he can push it from the other direction. We still are very far apart, but this was, I was very happy that we managed, don't look at this, we managed to improve the bound. So there is exponential and polynomial gap. It's a gap between polynomial and exponential, but now it's sub-exponential, and the polynomial is arbitrary large polynomial, so we pushed it a little bit, and there is more to be done, and you're welcome to look at the paper. And so this was, and we don't only go to coffee place. Well, we were in our, probably we spend maybe seven times in a coffee place. So you are now I shared you two of these cases. We were together in this beautiful lecture at the Institute by Jonathan Israel on the history of the basic human rights, and this was a very nice lecture that you can see online in the video of the Institute. And I remember one thing, I remember anecdote that after the lecture I came to the lecturer in Feldhau and I said that this was an excellent lecture, and looked at me and said, yes, it was a very good lecture, and this was a little bit unusual. And then he said, and it's true that I have a beard, but I'm not the lecturer. He pointed me to the other lecturer. Okay, as a mathematician, we know we fail once. So I went to the true lecturer and also complimented him for. So I want to mention two conferences. In 02, one was a conference about combinatorial method in analysis in Edinburgh, and one conference in Vancouver. The 2002 is significant here. First of all, they were really a great mathematical event. It's significant, it's more or less half the way between the time that I started and I think many people to relate analytical method with combinatorics and theoretical computer science and between today. And it's very interesting to see what was achieved in the first half, in the first, say, 14 years, and what was achieved in the second 14 years. So this was in 2002. People who are now So for example, a person who is now 42 then at that year was 28. I can give you more examples of that. This is a multi-level, multi-depth lecture. So anyway, this is part of the talks. So actually, in Vancouver, Jean was there, and in Edinburgh, we had a really remarkable series lecture, and I think I was confused. I thought Bourgain was there, and he was not. But wow, remarkable thing! There was lectures about Boolean functions that I gave, and about geometric, the local theory of Banach space by Egon Schechtman, and about the restriction and KKA problem by Terry Tao, and there were many such lectures. And in all the lectures, the dominant name was Bourgain. So we heard about this aspect of Bourgain work, that aspect. Okay, I want to move on. And I want to mention the main body of work where we collaborated. So this goes 10 years. So certainly nothing happened in the day in our collaboration between 2000 and 2010. I keep working on the things mentioned here, and John worked on a lot of other things. I think one thing he told me about the subset, the sum product theorem, that for him it was sort of a miracle that he has this method that he doesn't need to work hard to prove a remarkable open problems. He still worked hard, but it's true that the sum product theorem that was mentioned here was something. And this happened after these two conferences, so at least the main connection. So I want to mention the Erdős-Reni model and Marcus Jan. So let me just describe you a very basic model. You have a graph G, and we study a new graph H obtained by taking every edge of G at random with probability P independently. So if G is a complete graph, then this is random graph theory, essentially, studying this. And if G is a grid in RD, which can be either infinite grid or it can be some rectangular part of the infinite grid, then essentially this model is called the percolation model. And okay, now I have to be a little bit technical, and I'll just mention that the discrete n-dimensional cube, omega n, is the set of 0, 1 vectors of length n. We will denote the uniform probability distribution by mu. We immediately generalize it in a few seconds. A Boolean function is a function from omega n to 0, 1. A Boolean function is monotone if it cannot decrease when you switch coordinate from 0 to 1. And now, when we have a monotone Boolean function, we can look at the mu p measure. So this is the Bernoulli measure, where a probability of every coordinate to be 1 is p, and 0 is 1 minus p. And when we have a monotone function, then the probability that the function is 1 according to the Bernoulli measure is a monotone function of p. And it usually goes up. Well, it goes up. It's monotone. But in many cases, the place where there is a quick move between 0 and 1 is a short interval. And we will make some notation. So the place where the probability, the p where the probability is 1/2, we call it the critical probability. And the interval where we move from probability for the function being 1/10 to 9/10, we call it the threshold interval. And we will look at the length of the threshold interval and take its inverse. And in this lecture, we will define the quantity I of f to be 1/ this length. And we call it the influence of f. So here I really make a small abuse of the usual way this is described, just to make it somehow more self-contained and quicker. So we are interested in this interval where the function moves, the interval of probabilities when this function moves from being very close to zero where to the point where it's very close to one. And a sharp threshold corresponds to the case where this passage is sharp, is little off one. And then there is a remarkable sequence or the sequence of works which we can initiate with the Rousseau 0-1 law. It's also related to some earlier work from different direction by Margulis. This is Lucio Rousseau, who had a very creative contributions to this area. And then there was a result by Khan, myself, and Nati Lineal, and some extension of it in a paper with Bourgain and Katzenelson, and the three of us, and some work of Talagrand, and work of me with Friedgut, and another work with Friedgut. And essentially, what these papers tell you is that when the critical probability is bounded from 0 and from 1, a Boolean function has a sharp threshold, so it moves quickly, the probability from 0 to 1, unless it is a junta. A junta is that it essentially depends on a bounded set of variables. So this is in rough term. And in particular, when the function is symmetric and a transitive group, so when all the variables are equal, then it cannot be a junta. We cannot have democracy and the junta simultaneously, at least for a larger, then the influence is at least a constant time log n. So the threshold of this interval is at most 1 over log n. And in my most important joint work with Jean Bourgain was to try to understand how this log n can be improved for specific group of permutations. And let me tell you the result again. So we looked at an arbitrary transitive group of permutations, although we concentrated on primitive groups. And we had several examples in mind. For example, graph properties, they are described by Sn acting on pairs. So this is an important example of group of permutation. And then what we show is that this quantity, 1 over the threshold interval, essentially it can, if we look at the worst possible Boolean function for a given permutation group, then there's only certain values it can obtain. It can behave like square root of n. This is for the alternating and symmetric group. And then it can be a power of log n. It can be between log n square it can behave like log n square. It can behave like plus minus a little bit. It can behave like log n to the 3 half. It can behave like log n to the 4 third, and so on and so forth. And then if it's smaller than log n, and then it can go down to log n times log n, and then below that it can behave in an arbitrary way. So this is a theorem. Okay, here is another description of the theorem. If it's smaller than log n to 1.9, then it's already smaller than log n to the 3 half. And of course, what we do is stronger. We identify the relevant parameter for the primitive group which describe the threshold behavior or the influence, the minimal influence for Boolean function with this symmetry. And this is a very interesting thing. And the work had two parts. The most important is to show, to improve this log n, to find techniques, Fourier theoretic techniques, to improve this log n. And improving this log n is a big deal. We want to find general techniques to be able to push it further. And this is one part. And I think we first managed to push it, for example, for graph properties to log n to the 3 halves. And then there was some iterative method we choose, really very hard technology that I have nothing to do with further improving it, even with the first. Then there was the other direction which show which classified this parameter for all primitive groups. This, of course, relies on the classification of finite simple group on very detailed understanding we these days have or not these days. This was actually quite a long time ago, but 20 years ago, but on permutation groups, primitive permutation groups. Recently, last year, there was a very surprising application of our result. And I will not tell you what it says on technical terms, but it proved for the first time that the erasure, the Reed-Miller codes achieve capacity on erasure channel. So actually, this is a breakthrough result. People conjectured it for many years. In fact, they didn't have any codes with achieved capacity. Then there was a very important development, the discovery of polar codes. But still, this was outstanding, and this was proved. And they used our result for linear groups. For linear group of permutations, we get a tiny improvement from log n to log n times log n. on the threshold behavior, but this is sufficient for this application. Now I would like to mention another major contribution of Jean to the study of threshold behavior or influences of Boolean function, and this refers to another case where the critical probability itself is little of one. So we have sequence of functions where the critical probability is not bounded away between 0 and 1, but it is little of 1. And this is this describes one more order of magnitude of difficulty. And there the breakthrough, so this is something which Friedwood and I were interested, he worked on it, and he had a breakthrough result which says that a monotone graph property with coarse threshold, and coarse threshold means that the threshold is the same order of magnitude as the critical probability. And if this is the case, then for graph properties, it have a local structure. And shortly afterwards, Jean Bourgain, when he saw this result, he found an entirely different way to study a coarse threshold for general Boolean function. And there he didn't show such a strong structure theorem, but he showed that every Boolean function with coarse threshold has substantial locally defined ingredients. So again, I mentioned this only in terms of words, and it's getting to the details is quite interesting, but we'll not be able to do it. And this was Bourgain's theorem, and both Friedwood's theorem, but even more so Bourgain's theorem, became a very useful tool to prove for specific questions in probabilistic combinatorics that there is a sharp threshold, that the threshold interval is little o of the critical probability. And this is an important property. Usually, to move from the combinatorial question to the sharp threshold is also can be a very complicated combinatorial work, but at least this supplies a method that you can base your work on. And in 2010, Hamed Khatami found a remarkable extension of Bourgain theorem, which gave a structure theorem for Boolean function with coarse threshold. And this is a strengthening, and it is also a very important development. Strictly speaking, it doesn't imply Friedwood theorem because there is some delicate issue of monotonicity, but it is quite a breakthrough. We were very happy with it. Okay, so I want to mention one starting development on this area. As I mentioned, a consequence of Friedwood theorem that he proved in his original paper is that random ksat, I think this should be capital SAT, has a sharp threshold. And Jean and 2 years ago, Jean Ding, Ellen Slein, and Nick Hassan proved that they discover what is this threshold. And they did it for the case where K is large. And then for this case, there were a body of work by physicists based on what's called the replica method that predicted where the threshold is, and they managed to prove it. And this very general abstract theorem are very crucial because usually what they can prove is that the probability is bounded away from zero at certain point. And then when you prove that the probability is bounded away from zero, then very quickly you move to the other, to being very close to one. I should mention another major challenge that I posed in a paper with Jeff Kahn, and it is to extend this Friedwood-Bourgain-Khatami result to places away from the critical probabilities. So to understand the situation where the probability that the function is one is also very small. So there are some concrete conjectures there that extend these results, and that we made in 2006, and this is something which I mentioned to Jean several times, and I think he told me, you know, eventually I'll prove it, but I should mention another important result which came from, so I think this result somehow came when I first visited here at the Institute in 95. I came again in 2000, there was another very result in Bourgain answering a question of Johann Astad, And he showed, he showed that if you have a Boolean function, and if the Fourier-Walsh weights decay too quickly, faster than the square root of k, then, or faster than 1 over square root of k. Well, in any case, I didn't introduce this notion, so, but then this function is junta. And this was, like the other contribution of Bourgain, this was a very major contribution for the community, and the community in some cases also include Bourgain's co-authors. It takes years and sometimes many years to catch up with this method, with these ideas. I was very happy when Larry mentioned his experience because I didn't feel so bad about my experience. Let me mention another result about a Boolean function. So as you know, Mei-Chu Zhang, Zhang's wife, is by herself a prominent researcher in additive number theory, other areas. And she was not involved directly in the analysis of Boolean function, but there is some result known as the Chang inequality, which she outlined. And it's about the energy of the Fourier coefficient on the first level of Boolean function. And this had a lot of application also in our corner of the forest. And this is Chang inequality. And recently, we had several works with some co-authors on correlation inequalities, some attempts to tackle the Quattel conjecture in extremal combinatorics, and this result is quite important in this line of thought. And if you want to read the entropic proof of Chang inequality, there is a 2012 paper by Impalacio, Moore, and Russell, which present it. I want to mention now another direction, which again I will only mention, but this relates to some work that I do. And as you know, percolation, I mentioned the percolation model, which is essentially a random subgraph of the two-dimensional grid or random subgraph of the rectangular area of two-dimensional grid. And this is an area where there were amazing discoveries in the last 2 decades. I mentioned Russo, and then Russo, Seymour, Welsh. Well, this was even before. And then there was a proof by Kesten that the critical probability is 1/2. And at the critical probability for the infinite grid, there is the probability that there is percolation, that there is infinite cluster is 0. And there were some results about critical exponents. First, their existence in the earlier time, and then there were the Smirnov's conformal invariance theorem and Schramm's SLE6 theorem, and Garban, Pete, and Schramm managed to describe fairly accurately the Fourier. If you think about percolation as a Boolean function, they managed to describe fairly accurately the Fourier distribution, and this is related to some notion which is called noise stability that Peter mentioned. I didn't intend to mention it, but I just mentioned it now. And of course, we would like to understand percolation in 3 dimensions. This is a very difficult question. And I will mention to you two conjectures which are open. One is that if you look at 3-dimensional percolation for the whole z to the 3, and there is some critical percolation from which the probability, after which the probability of infinite cluster is positive, containing, let's say, infinite cluster is 1, and before the probability of infinite cluster is 0, and we want to understand what happened at the critical probability, there is a very important conjecture which says that there is no percolation at the critical probability. The no percolation at the critical probability is extremely general phenomena that we would like to understand. People, it may apply in very great generality, but we don't know it for the 3 dimension. Due to the work on the so-called lace expansion, we know it in high dimensions. But in high dimensions, we understand the behavior. So this is a Tom Spencer's work and subsequent work. We know the situation in high dimension very well, but we don't know what happened in 3 dimension. And there is another conjecture which says that the threshold window for the crossing event behaves like a power of the number of edges. So this is a power law. And you remember that for general setting, even to cross the log barrier is quite difficult. But for percolation, we hope for some very concrete. I think there is some recent hope among the experts, like these guys who have mentioned that maybe time is ripe to tackle again the three-dimensional case. And I was working about it with Gadi Kosma. So among these experts, I think only Gadi gives some hope that this Fourier method might be relevant. But we try to push it. I don't know. We didn't get so far. But I can show a picture of our effort. So there are all sorts of, you see, all sorts of things we would like to prove, all sorts of things that we can prove. We are fairly weak. There are some things which other people can prove. They can prove some. This is Hugo and Vincent. They can prove that there is a positive probability. A lot of things which are very easy in two dimensions, like Russo Simovich, become completely. But sometimes they can push it a little bit. And actually, Gadi is a great heroic person in three-dimensional models because he studied the scaling limit of loop arrays, random walk in three-dimension. And, you know, nobody there. So he has. Okay, I want to go back in history. And let me go to Zurich 94. So I don't know, this is the best quality picture I found over the internet yesterday. So you see that Jean is here with Ruth Dreyfus. She was later the president. She gave a wonderful lecture there. And Avi, who is the next speaker, is also here. He will. This was very good time. And Zurich, I was there. I think Avi won the Nevanlina Prize, and his family was there. And we also met, I remember we met for dinner, Jean and Mei Chu, and Jean's parents, and and Vitali, and my colleague Yoram Lienstrauss, and Lior Tzafrir, I'll mention in a minute. So we had really good times. It was very warm, and we swam in the lake. Okay, maybe I think I'm running after that. I will skip this slide. Okay. So I'm going back in time. So the one previous stage I met Jean was in IHES in the late 80s. And I have there is a picture of the two of us from that period. So let me mention to you my impression going back and back in time as a younger mathematician, which were further apart from this area, but many of my colleagues, about some things which I heard. So let me go back. So one thing that I remember I heard quite vividly was the solution of the lambda p conjecture. I think I heard it from my colleague, Leo Tzafri. He came enthusiastic one day and said, you know, Jean Bourgain settled the lambda p conjecture. And of course, I tell him, this is wonderful, but what is the lambda p conjecture? I was not in this field, but he said to me, it's very easy to explain. I think Jean once told me that he solved this conjecture while flying, so in a flight. But okay, another experience which is related to another institution which we cherish is the Oberwolfach. So I was a member of the cozy community of classical convexity in Oberwolfach. So I came first there to the 82 conference, and we had this conference studying convex sets. And at some point there was a union with the classical, with the community of people from Banach space theory who were making more and more important work in classical convexity. I don't remember the year where we first merged. This was a sort of a hostile takeover. No, maybe Vitali, remember the first Oberwolfach meeting we were together? Maybe 88 or 90. And of course, this was quite a scene to see. And I remember this is from a poster for Vitali's 70th birthday. But Vitali tried to explain to the convex geometers that this is how you have to draw convex sets in high dimensions. And eventually explained. Eventually they were convinced. They know, you know, the, and it has some truth to it. And let me mention some important work that I remember in classical convexity. One was the Busselmann-Petty problem that eventually was settled very satisfactorily. I will not mention it, but let me mention a famous conjecture, the slicing conjecture. Is there a universal constant C greater than zero so that every d-dimensional convex body of volume 1 has a d minus 1 dimensional section of volume at least C? So this is a wonderful conjecture. It is related to question, isoperimetric questions, which came in theoretical computer science in the work of Shimonovich and Lovas. And I think the world record essentially is due to Bourgain, but Boaz Clartag was managed to shave a log factor. So I'll call it Bourgain Clartag square root D, the fourth root of D. So the challenge for you is to lower it to a constant. And now I think the last few minutes of my lecture, I want to mention, going back earlier, the experience in Jerusalem in the mid-late 80s. And there, let me just give you a quick view of our department at that time. We had a strong group in Banach theory, which included Yoram Lindstrauss and Lior Tzafriri and Moritz Zipin, Tomek Shilkovsky, and others. And then we have a strong ergodic theory group, Hillel Fürstenberg, Benji Weiss. Izzy Katzeleso was just on the move to Stanford. He's also a harmonic theorist. And the PDE group with Agmon and Pazzi, and Alger group with Amitsur, Mann, and Lubotsky, and Combinatorics in computer science and logic, probability, game theory. And Bourgain was a regular, Jean was a regular visitor in our department in these years, in the late 80s. And of course, his main hosts were the Banach theory group, but he had also strong ties with the ergodic theory groups. I think Asaf mentioned, often he could do things that they cannot do, and often he could do things that in a complicated way that they could simplify. So there was some mathematical dialogue. Very impressive. And the PDE group, so he got interest with the PDE group. So I think in later years, suddenly Agmon was, every time he came to give a lecture, Agmon would come and was very much interested. And with the other group, he didn't have connection at that time. But as we will mention in a minute, he had a strong connection with the algebra group, with the work of Lubotsky and others, and with the combinatorics group and the CS group, and so on. So let me mention a few memories from this time. So one great mathematician in my department was Yoram Lindstrauss, and Jan and Yoram were very close friends, and they were interested in many similar things. And one common interest, which I can understand, is Banach space defined by classical theorem for finite dimensional convexity. So I came from finite dimensional convexity. So for example, you have a theorem that in a convex body, in a compact convex body, every extreme point is the limit of exposed point. Extreme point is a point which is not in the convex hull of the other point, and exposed point is the intersection of the body with a supporting hyperplane. And this is a very nice, but every CRM in finite dimension is a source of a definition of a property in infinite dimension. So this related. And there were studies on such properties going back to Yoram's PhD thesis, and I think the Radon-Nikodym property was studied very much. Another direction, which again I could connect to is the study of approximation of zonoids by zonotopes and mixing time for symmetrization, which is a classical operation in convexity. So this was and let me mention two problems which were close to my interest. So Odette Schramm proved in 89 that every convex set K in RD, sorry, this should be R. D can be covered by, well, this stands for square root 3 divided by square root 2 to the power d smaller homotets of a constant width completion of K. So every set, every convex set, every compact convex set can be completed to a set of constant widths of the same diameter. And this set of convex widths, according to Schramm's theorem, can be covered by this number of smaller homotets. And the Bourgain and Linnenstrauss proved in 91 that every convex set in RD can be covered by precisely the same number, square root 3 divided by square root 2 to the power d, of balls of smaller diameter. Here, smaller and same does not make any difference, because if you have the same diameter, you convert it by d plus 1. And we cannot beat, until now, we cannot beat this bound, square root 3 divided by square root 2. I'm sure it can be, it can, we can push it further. In the second, for balls, they also show that you cannot go below 1.06. Even if you just care about sets of smaller diameter and not about this particular construction, we don't know how to push this bound below. And this is related to a problem, to the Borsuk problem, which I looked at from different angles. So now I want to mention another colleague of mine, Lior Tzafriri, and the work of Jean and Lior. And again, this is both a work and a close friendship. And they work on the Cadison-Singer conjecture. And I will not tell you what the Cadison-Singer conjecture, I just want to tell you the part which is appealing or can be appealing to a combinatorialist. And the Cadison-Singer conjecture is about coloring the rows of certain n by n matrices with C colors. So there is a conjecture that certain matrices, you can color the rows with C colors. With the coloring should relate to some properties of the minors, which correspond to this set of rows. And the conjecture that you can color it with C colors, but if you can color it with C colors, then you first have to show that one color, you can color with one color a constant fraction, 1 over C of the rows. So this would be the first step to any coloring theorem. And this is what Bourgain and Tzafriri proved. And as a matter of fact, they proved something stronger, which give fractional coloring with C color. So fractional coloring, the interplay between coloring and fractional coloring, this is one of the most important topics, both in combinatorics and theoretical computer science. I hope it's okay. And this also appears in this case. And it also appears in the problem that Gilles Pizier presented yesterday about Sidon set. So I think there, the analog of the Bourgain-Tzafriri theorem is a theorem of Gilles, and we need to move. So as you know, in 2013, the full conjecture was settled by Adam Marcus, Dan Spielman, and Nikhil Srivastava. Adam is here, and I even challenge him to go ahead and prove the Sidon set conjecture. And Jean told me once, referring to the proof, that a proof of this kind is how a proof of the Riemann hypothesis would look like. So this was sort of a philosophical meditation. But okay, so I tried to find over the net a picture. I didn't find a picture of Jean and Yoram. I found this picture of Koenig, Figel, Bourgain, Tzafriri, although I don't recognize. You know, Jean usually wear whiter shirts, and I'm not so sure. I don't recognize Hermann. But is it okay? This is correct? I mean, and I certainly recognize Lior Tzafriri. There is also some guy lying there. I don't know what. Very, very suspicious, so I don't know what. Okay, I want to. So I think now that I reached the age 60, maybe can I take. I do something I never did, but can I take 2 more minutes? Yeah. Okay. Maybe I should have done, maybe I should have tried it before. I don't know. Anyway, so. So another wonderful story, the story of Jean and Vitaly. And you know, the Israeli mathematics in 1970 was, I think one can say it was excellent. And then there was a large wave of immigration, and it really gave it a huge leap forward. So it was excellent before, but it was amazingly better afterwards, because new ideas, new temperament, new methods, new areas, I don't know, everything. And I think Vitaly is largely responsible for this development on the global scale, but a similar thing happened in the Banach group theory, where Vitaly came and this changed things. So I want to mention a few things about the work of Jean and Vitaly. And again, there is some small angle which relate to my interest. And there is a famous Mahler conjecture. And Mahler conjecture says, if you have a centrally symmetric body, K, in RD. A centromeric body is that if x belongs to the body, then also minus x belongs to the body. And then the conjecture is that the volume of the body times the volume of the dual is greater or equal than the volume of the cube times the volume of the dual. So the cube minimizes this, quantity. And this is still open. One difficulty of this conjecture is that there are many cases of equalities. There are polytopes called the Hanner polytopes, which all of them satisfy this equality. And then Bourgain and Milman proved that this is true up to a multiplicative factor of constant to the n. And this is a great result because these quantities are of the order of n factorial. So constant to the n is almost nothing in this scale of n factorial. And the current world record is pi over 4 for C. And this was achieved in a beautiful work by Greg Cooperberg. And there is a combinatorial, so you may know that I'm very interested in phase numbers of polytopes and of cellular sets of various kinds. And essentially, in my 95 visits to the IS, one thing we had, or my main scientific thing was a seminar we ran about questions about phase numbers of polytopes and more general cellular cells with Bob McPherson, Mark Goreski, Tom Braden, and a few other people. And I had a conjecture which is similar and that very simple to state. If you have a centrally symmetric d-dimensional polytope, then it has at least 3 to the d non-empty phases. So very simple statement. Again, one difficulty is that all these Hanner polytopes satisfy this equality. And I should say that this conjecture was inspired by a seminal work which also related phase numbers and geometry by Figel, Lindenstrauss, and Milman of a few years earlier. And let me mention that recently, maybe a year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I don't remember, somehow time passing too quickly recently, but Archen Avidan, Karasev, and Ostrover found a new approach to the Mahler conjecture through some isoperimetric result for symplectic geometry. So as you know, it's not only Jean in the coming year was a close collaborator with many of my colleagues, Alex Lubotsky, Noga Alon. Noga is actually one of the great leaders in the polynomial method that I started the talk with. Avi Vigdorzon, Yuval Peres, Elon Lindenstrauss, Gadi Kozma, Zev Rudnik, Amir Yehudayov, and Amir Shpilka, so there are two Amirs for the Tali Kaufman and many others. And for example, can you hear the degree of a function? So this is, we heard about it. There is a work with Gadi and Jean, and Jean with Alex Gambord, they settled the Lubotsky 1-2-3 conjecture, and there is quantum unique ergodicity and so on. And I should say that, Jean has amazing, this was mentioned before, Jean has amazing dedication to mathematics and great enthusiasm to it. And even if you know Jean somewhat on a sporadic basis, you realize that Jean also has a great commitment and admiration of Eric Bourgain, his son. So in the old days when Eric was very young, I heard mainly about swimming interest. But more recently, it looks that they also collaborate mathematically. So here is, we go back in time. So here's a very picture of Jean as a young person. Let me conclude by saying that when we run, I told the story backward, but when we run the story forward in time, we are amazed by how many startling new connections and applications were found. New tools were discovered, hard problems were cracked. Sometimes via remarkable new proofs, sometimes a very difficult proof, sometimes surprisingly simple proof. And we are also amazed by the many young and wonderful people who join our scene. And Jean stands out as one of the greatest mathematicians in our time and quite possibly in all times. So thank you very much.